Thank you. Good morning, Grace. I'm so glad you're all here to worship with us this morning. I'm Michelle Sutherland. I'm the director of music here, and we have a special treat for us today. The group that's coming to the platform right now is His Messengers, and we're going to be worshiping with them as they lead us in the music and worship today. If you're new today or visiting for the first time, on the back of the chair in front of you is a Let's Keep in Touch card, and I invite you to fill out one of those and drop it in the offering basket on your way out. And we also have a special gift bag for those that are visiting with us. Let's see what else. Oh, there's still baby bottles to be picked up, so if you feel like putting your change into one of those bottles, every bottle that's filled up, Pastor Cliff and Jane are donating an extra, what, $17? He's not listening. Oh, well.
Make us sweat. Bring me lots of baby bottles. We'll give an extra $5 for every bottle that comes in.
There you go. $5 for every bottle that comes in. Let's see. They need to come in next week, the 26th. Also next week, the 26th, we're going to take photos again for our photo directory. So if you need a new photo for our directory, I'll be taking them right back here in the prayer room after worship. There's a sign-up sheet in the Narthex Sheepskate for those of you that might be interested in joining the new members class. It will meet every Sunday afternoons at 4 o'clock, and the dates and everything are out there, and it includes dinner. Let's see. This Wednesday, in my tradition growing up, I didn't go to Ash Wednesday services. But since coming here and for the last couple of years, we've been doing an Ash Wednesday service. And I invite you to come at 11 o'clock on Wednesday for our service. There will be the imposition of ashes, but it's a very meditative and quiet service where we reflect on what Christ did and what he continues to do for us as we live our life as Christians in this kind of crazy world. Let's see. Before I have you stand and greet one another, I was looking at the front of the bulletin today, and it says, today's service is faith talking, faith walking, and after you greet your neighbors, be sure and give them a hug or a handshake or an elbow bump, whatever you're comfortable with. We're also going to have faith singing today, so please stand and greet your neighbors.
In 2001, two local quartets formed to create an ensemble of men dedicated to sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ through music. Over 20 years later, the music goes on, Please welcome his messengers.
We're gonna sing just as long as it takes for a song to make sad heavy spirits free. We're gonna keep making music that carries the secret that Jesus is liberty. We're gonna turn off the sounds and we'll drag people down into the pit of this haunted sea. With a sweet happy tune, he is coming soon for his children like you and me.
It's a song that'll carry a message along through the densest of foggy nights. And a tune is a rope that can throw a man home when he's going down for the third time. It's a sweet melody that can cut your heart free from the chains of a past defeat. You can suddenly see through the sweet harmony a path for your wandering feet.
We're going to sing just as long as it takes for a song to make sad heavy spirits free. We're going to keep making music that carries the secret that Jesus is liberty. We're going to turn off the sounds that will drag people down through the pit of this haunted sea. With a sweet happy tune, he is coming soon for his children like you and me.
Don't tell me the world is a hopeless old place and I might as well just give in. Through the tube and gloom, life's a waiting room for the blow that'll do us all in. I can't sympathize when before my eyes is a hope shining bright as day. I gotta follow the song that keeps drawing me up with my feet dancing all the way.
We're gonna sing just as long as it takes for a song to make sad heavy spirits free. We're gonna keep making music that carries the secret that Jesus is liberty. We're gonna turn off the sounds that will drag people down to the pit of despondency. With a sweet happy tune, he is coming soon for his children like you and me. We're gonna sing just as long as it takes for a song to make sad heavy spirits free. We're gonna keep making music that carries the secret that Jesus is liberty. We're gonna turn off the sounds that will drag people down to the pit of this haunted sea. With a sweet happy tune, he is coming soon for his children like you and me. Yeah, with a sweet happy tune, he is coming soon for his children like you and me.
Hey, Bruce. second. My name's Mike, and I'm one of the founding members. We've been singing since 2001, so we're going on about 22 years singing around the valley, and God's really been blessing us a lot. And on my left here is Mike. I'm Mike number one. He's Mike number two. And he sings lead for us. Next to him is John, and John sings lead also one of our soloists. And the next to him is Bruce. Bruce and I are the bass, and we're not only the basses, we're the founding members of the group. So basses have longevity, I think. next to me on my right here is Larry, and he sings tenor. That's that high part. Does some solos for us. Also, another solo performer is Stuart, and Stuart sings tenor along with Larry. And then the next two gentlemen, this is Russ. He's just recently joined us, and he sings baritone along with our guitarist, who also sings baritone. And this guy on the end, I think he plays the piano. He's going to play it for you today. It'd be a great. And then in the far back corner of the room is our sound man. He's an amazing guy. It makes us sound really, really awesome, and so we're glad that he's here. We're going to go into our next song. It's a really great message, and I think the words are going to be up here, what we needed. God gave us what we needed, not what we thought we wanted, not what we thought we needed, that he gave us a Savior who was pure, sinless, dying for the wrong that we had done. So, what we needed.
We have never seen all through history that a man could save himself. Every work of man since the world began never kept one soul from hell.
But God looked down in grace and love and met our greatest need.
What we needed was a holy sacrifice, God's only begotten Son.
When the world all around was bound for hell,
all earthly hope was lost.
What we needed was a grace and mercy God provided on the rugged cross. Many men have tried to be satisfied by the things this world affords. They have placed their faith in another way and rejected Christ our Lord.
But the Father longs to reveal to them what they needed all along.
It is their to was a holy sacrifice, God's only begotten Son.
When the world all around was bound for hell,
all earthly hope was lost.
What we needed was a grace and mercy God provided on a rugged cross. What we needed was a Savior, pure and sinless, dying for the wrong we'd done. What we needed was a holy sacrifice, God's only begotten Son.
When the world all around was bound for hell,
all earthly hope was lost.
What we needed was a grace and mercy God provided on a rugged cross. What we needed was a grace and mercy God provided on a rugged cross.
Don't know how it happens and why. when he starts playing, sometimes there's often uncontrolled foot tapping that starts taking place. It's connected to something he's doing because it seems to stop when he finishes playing the piano. But anyway, Nathan Mott, play for us.
Sing the story. awesome God we serve. It's amazing how he loved us so much. And this song was written about that, about who are we that God loved us so much.
Like a stranger in the dark.
takes all of our burdens away. Isn't that great? That's the name of the song. Jesus took my burdens all away.
Jesus took my burdens, took them all away. Turned my night of darkness into brightest day. Place his arms around me, lest I go astray. Jesus took my burdens all away. All my life was full of sin. When Jesus spoke to me, all my heart was heavy laden, full of misery. But he changed my life completely, set my spirit free. Jesus took my burdens all away.
Yes, Jesus,
Jesus took my burdens,
took them
all away.
Turned my
night of darkness into brightest day.
I should be on. How's that? There we go. The techno genius at work again. You realize that these guys had like three weeks notice. We had another group lined up. They lost their lead singer, lost his voice. And we called up and they said, well, yeah, as long as we have enough time to find ties for everybody, we can do this. So we're really glad to have you, his messengers. And what a good name. Let's give them a round of applause. So there's a lot going on around the church, as you could tell from Michelle's announcements. There's a lot going around this church. I love this church. There, God is doing great things. Hey, you know, some people may not know it, but because there was a shift in the schedule this year, March for Life is happening this week, and if you would like to participate in that, see Arlene. Arlene, would you stand, please? Because we need to see your smile and face. And I think there are some other people who are going to be participating. Would you stand if you're going to participate, if you're here? Whoa. Okay, I know you're out there. Yeah, you guys are shy. Okay, so you want to see, take note of this. This is a very important thing. We believe in life here. Okay, we believe that life is valuable, that God made us in his image, and that every human being has intrinsic value, and that we were made in the image of God. Isn't that great? Y'all are good looking. Man. Well, let's take a few minutes to pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of being here today and have our friends from his messengers here. We know that that's your message that they're all about. And we would ask, Lord, that we would hear the message of the gospel today, that we would be attuned to the good news that you have for us. For, O Lord, you are worthy of all glory, honor, and praise. And we come to you as people who desperately need to hear your voice, as ones who need your strength day by day by day. Lord, we would pray that you would be speaking to our hearts and our minds, that we would represent you well in this world that so desperately needs help. Lord, we think of the people of East Palestine. We think of the horrible things that have been done to them. And we would pray that somehow you would bring relief to these dear friends, and that the light and love of Christ would go out from Christians all over that area. Lord, we pray for the responsiveness of our federal government. Indeed, Lord, we do pray that you would be speaking to the hearts and minds of all in our government, whatever level, whether it's the presidency or the Congress or the judiciary or the state and local governments. Lord, we need to hear your voice. We're living in a world, Lord, that's gone way far, 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 far from you. So far, we are involved in some of the most blind and evil practices. And so we pray that you would be calling us back, and that you would be using your people, that you would be breathing on the fire of our hearts, that we would be aflame with faith and love and joy, that we would represent you well with people who don't yet know you. Lord, we thank you for this church. We thank you for who are intent on honoring you by studying your word, by living your word, by speaking your word, that others might hear and know. And Lord, we would pray that as we continue to gather this morning around your word and in worship and song, that you would be blessed and glorified. For we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I just love it when we get debts and trespasses crosswise at each other. You know, me personally, debts is very important. Yes, you know, have those debts removed. But it tells me that we have a variety of people from a variety of different backgrounds. And you know what? That's the good news of the gospel, because it cuts across all of the boundaries that we have in this world. The gospel cuts across the boundaries of cities and states and nations, the boundaries of race and and class, and it's a beautiful thing. Well, guys, I want you to know that I grew up singing. I grew up in a singing family. My father sang opera, literally, yes, and my sisters, they sang bluegrass and folk music, and my mom and I, we sang around a campfire. So we were a singing family. And when I was a kid, I was in a boys' choir at the church, and I sang in it for years, and I loved it, mostly, that is, and until some bullies from school found out that I was in the Methodist Church choir. And you know what kind of robes we wore? You ever see those red robes with like the white frilly tops? Oh, it wasn't long before they started saying things like, oh, choir boys, squeaks like a church mouse, or worse, red robes and ruffles, looks like a girl. Well, it was just horrible. I was very embarrassed. I was ashamed to go to be affiliated with the church in this way. So I did what every self-respecting boy, seventh grade boy that is, would do, and I quit the choir. And I was done. I didn't want anybody to know that I actually went to church either. And kids in North Jersey could be brutal. But to make a long story short, by the time I reached the middle of my freshman year in college, God had gotten a hold of me. And when I look back on it, it wasn't just one person who convinced me to look into Jesus, to commit my life to Him. It was a multitude of unashamed people who shined the light and love of Jesus Christ into my head and into my heart, and it changed me. And although there have been some ups and downs over the years, I can honestly say that I have been and I am now, and by God's grace, I will always be unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He's the one who puts a song in my heart that I utterly cannot hide. Because of Him, my life has been transformed. My trajectory is no longer in the wrong direction. My trajectory is towards heaven. By the way, I'm totally against hell. I'm against anybody going there. So that's why I'm a preacher. I just want... How about you, though? How about you? Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ? Has He gotten a hold of your life? Has He? Has He really gotten a hold of your life? Have you experienced His love, mercy, and grace? Have you made Him your Lord and Savior? Does He put a song in your heart that you just can't hide? Are you honored? Are you unashamed to belong to Jesus? I love the fact that these men are unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that they want to be His messengers. They sing because the power and presence of the Holy Spirit has given them a deep joy that will never quit. The Apostle Paul once wrote in Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith." I've got an echo back here. These men know the word. So these two verses, friends, are the essence of the Christian faith. These two verses, in fact, were the foundation for the Protestant Reformation back in the day. Some of you remember that. These two verses answer the question that Job asked long, long ago: how can a man be made righteous before God? And this is a question because, in case you hadn't noticed, not one of us, I don't know, and if you have never committed a sin in your life, I want you to see me afterwards because I want to meet you. Because every one of us has probably sinned more than on one occasion every day. What do you do with that? How are you made right before a holy and righteous God? Well, may I suggest to you that all religious pursuits in the world today are some sort of an attempt to answer that question. How can a man, a person, be accepted by God? And every one of those religions out there, except for the Christian faith, answered that it is through human effort. And yet Paul once wrote in his letter to the Roman church, and he was very clear, that we don't win favor with God by our good works. We don't. He instead unequivocally quoted from the Old Testament prophet Habakkuk, "The righteous shall live by faith." In other words, it's through faith in Jesus Christ that we are made right with God. If you've been privileged, in fact, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Anyone can come, but you have to go through Jesus Christ. So it's at once exclusive and inclusive. If you've been privileged to read the rest of Paul's letter to the Romans, you quickly learn that on our own power, all of our good works are, and I quote, "as filthy rags." That all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. As Paul wrote in his letter to the church at Ephesus, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not of your own doing, it is the gift of God." A gift! Ha! It's not the result of our works, so that no one may boast. Well, if our good works are not going to save us or win us favor before God's wrath, where do we find good works fitting in? Well, I'm glad you asked that question, because Paul immediately answers it in Ephesians 2:10, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them. In other words, our good works are the evidence of our faith. They're not the way that we win favor in the eyes of God. They are the evidence of our faith. Pay attention to this. Once we've been invited Christ into our hearts as Lord and Savior, we no longer have to function on our own wisdom and power. That's why in Romans 1:16, Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes." Paul doesn't have to be ashamed, because in Christ, he's now empowered by the Holy Spirit. This was the promise of Jesus to his disciples in Acts 1:8 at the ascension, where Jesus said, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the very ends of the earth." Well, why do we need the power of the Holy Spirit, friends? Well, I don't know about you, but maybe you haven't noticed, but our world has gone kind of nuts. I mean, our world is offering all kinds of zany and, quite frankly, evil solutions to the problems that we face right now. A one-world government, Marxism, open borders, transgenderism, critical race theory, drag queens teaching our little children. Where does this come from? I can tell you where it comes from, but I'll spare you the details. I think you know. At the same time, people are not embracing the cross as they used to. No, there are fewer people following the Lord Jesus Christ today than ever before, and it breaks my heart, because that's where the solutions to our problems come. People rejected the cross in the same way back in Paul's time. In 1 Corinthians 1:23, he said that the cross was to the Jews a stumbling block and to the Greeks foolishness. See, Paul ran into resistance everywhere he went on his missionary journeys. He was imprisoned in Philippi, chased out of Thessalonica, smuggled out of Damascus in Berea, laughed at in Athens, called a fool in Corinth. He was declared a blasphemer and a lawbreaker in Jerusalem. He was stoned and left for dead in Lystra. And everywhere he went, people pushed back because of the message that he preached. It wasn't sophisticated enough. It was not in line with their morality or lack thereof. The simple, unadulterated gospel of Jesus Christ was offensive to them. Our cancel culture isn't unlike the opposition Paul faced either. But Paul became the most successful missionary in the history of the church. He did. He never gave up. Why didn't he give up? Because he was fearless. Why was he fearless? Because the gospel is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. Many of us, I know a lot of you out there, face kids and grandkids, friends and neighbors, strangers and dangers, who have bought the lies of secularism, wokeism, brokeism, paganism, hedonism, climatism, whateverism, and it's the power of the gospel that will give us the right words and the right attitude and the right timing with which to share the good news of the gospel with a people who don't want to hear it but desperately need it. So don't you give up. You got to be like Paul. Why do they desperately need it? Because the gospel turns our lives inside out and upside down. It places demands on our lives to experience transformation. What? How is that? You see, when we fall in love with Jesus Christ, we discover that he accepts us just as we are, but he never leaves us where we are. Can I get a witness on that? Is there anybody back here? Thank you. I knew these guys could give me a witness on that. That's good. That's Baptist talk, guys. Okay, anyway, you know, we begin to love what Christ loves when we've welcomed him into our heart, when we've made him the Lord of our lives, and we begin to hate what Christ hates. And Christ does hate our sin. He does. He loves sinners, but he hates sin, and so should we. See, when the Holy Spirit begins to work in our lives, he makes us holy. Wow, isn't that cataclysmic? And it's sometimes a very painful process, but he doesn't give up. In Galatians 5, 23 through 24, Paul tells us that the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives produces fruit. What does it produce? It produces answers the world doesn't give us, because it produces in us love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. I think I got all those mixed up, but you know, it produces good fruit in us that ultimately begins to push the bad fruit out. Actually, God prunes it out of our lives, but it's this fruit that transforms us and makes us new creations. The old is gone, the new has come, and it's what transforms our culture, our politics, our schools, our communities. It makes a whole lot of sense, and it makes us whole. This power of the gospel gives us meaning and purpose and hope. Scriptures say that God will make all things new when he is Lord. The power of the gospel changes lives, dear friends. This is the good news, and Paul isn't ashamed of it. And this is the powerfully good news that we proclaim to a dying world when we unashamedly stand up, step out, and start speaking up for Jesus. This is why there's a huge revival going on back at a place called Asbury's, it used to be college, now it's university. I actually took 10 doctoral classes there. And man, there is a revival going on there like crazy. It's going on 24/7. They're praying round the clock. They're worshiping. The word is going out. It's spreading to other universities. It's spreading across this country. And I'll tell you what, I believe it's happening here. Now you're going, what? With a preacher like you? You got to be kidding. Well, the Holy Spirit can work in spite of me, I'm just saying. And I believe it is happening, because all I have to do is see it in your lives and in your spirits. I hear it in your voices and in your witness. People's lives are being changed. People's lives are being deepened. People's lives are being transformed. It's an unquenchable joy that results. You see, the gospel is the good news of what Jesus has done for us. So don't ever be ashamed of it. Don't hide your light under a bushel. Trumpet it everywhere you go. And just let it be the song in your heart that sings you to sleep at night. Guys, take it away.
To the light.
production and help get some piano lessons for Nathan, because I think it'd be really good if you had a few more lessons. Awesome. We had a guy that just retired from our group last November. He was 94 years old, and this was his favorite song to sing. He's probably been singing for the Lord for 75 to 80 years almost. The longer I serve him, the sweeter it grows.
Since my life he controls. this world is not where we belong. We belong in a place that's being prepared for us.
Amen.
This world is not my home.
Amen.
This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at
Give it up for our friends. I've got a microphone. It sometimes works. It's good having you with us, man. It's great having you all here today. If you don't have a church home, you're always welcome to make it here. We pick up strays along the way every Sunday. And we're just happy to be happy in Jesus. You know, the scriptures say in Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again, rejoice. Well, we've got good reason to rejoice, and it's good to rejoice with you today. So as you go today, go rejoicing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, knowing that they will be with you. He will be with you to the very ends of the earth. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.